It's time to break out your poodle skirts and saddle.
Perspectives. I'm Chuck Gallagher, and with me today is a trio of wonderment. I've got all the news that matters, and they're going to be discussing them. Mary Ellen Mahan, how are you?
I'm fine, okay. Thank you.
Fred Levering?
Chuck, always good to see you.
And Fred Opalinski, Fred number two, one.
Good to be here, Chuck.
Good to be here. Normally we kick off with something in terms of local news and all that, but I thought in light of the recent firing of the head of the FBI, you all might want to kick in some comments on that. I'll just throw the ball up in the air and wait for somebody to grab it. No?
Apparently the White House thought this would be cheered by everybody, but it does not appear to be. And I think the timing of this was really strange. I mean, apparently Comey was on the verge of really kicking this into high gear. And
this being the investigation?
The investigation regarding possible Russian ties.
And Russian interference with the...
Right.
But as of today, there seems to be mixed opinions on... Did he or did he not ask for additional resources? I mean, there was testimony this morning from his replacement that said he did not. The reasons given on why Comey was fired contradict statements. I mean, there's like, they're showing play reels of, you know, a dozen different times where Trump praised Comey for what he did right up to when he was elected.
Including what he did with Hillary Clinton. And now that's supposedly the reason for his dismissal. And
the testimony this morning counteracted the claim that he had lost the faith of
saying that the spirit was good at the FBI, right?
There's still, though, the whole thing is just partisan politics, I think.
Yeah, but you've got Republicans coming out.
You know, the Democrats were all in a lather and said Comey's got to go when he did what he did at the tail end of the campaign. Now it's never mind. It was wrong to fire him because
nobody is saying what he did was right.
And what is this investigation? I mean, there is the whole catchphrase of hacking the election implies that the Russians manipulated the vote totals and stuff, and it's not even remotely possible.
I haven't heard anybody say that.
So
we manipulated public opinion.
Mm-hmm. I think, going back to the Comey firing, first of all, the timing, the way it was done, I think was atrocious. I mean,
he found out on television.
He was giving a lecture in California.
Unethical.
You know, to pick up the phone and call the man and say, hey, I'm sorry, we don't need you anymore, you're out of the job, would be one thing. Better still, face-to-face would have been even better, in my opinion.
Well, and the White House spokesperson said they did it the way they're supposed to, it was by letter. But he didn't get the letter, evidently.
Oh, he did get the letter.
He didn't get it before he heard it on television.
No.
Yeah.
I think there's so many other aspects that play into why this is such a big blow-up these days. It's like, if he took a decisive command step here in getting rid of Comey because he had so-called lost the faith of America, then why did he not do the same thing with Michael Flynn after Yates came in and expressed her concern? And given her testimony this past week, which I thought was, I think it should go down in the annals of how do you testify?
Yates for president.
Yeah, I mean, why did it take 14 days for him to take such, command?
It was 18 days, I believe.
18, sorry.
That's right. But the whole thing, you had the Democrats, you're saying, doing a flip. Get rid of Comey on one hand, on the other, how dare you get rid of him? Yeah. And you've got,
I haven't heard a Democrat say that he shouldn't have gone. I think it has to do with process and timing. Mm-hmm. And when you link it to Sally Yates and you link it to Sessions and Flynn and all the rest, the common thread is Russia.
Now, the irony is, as of this morning, do you know who they're throwing out the trial balloon to replace him?
Yeah, it might be
Garland.
Yeah, Garland.
Which just cracks me up. And then you do get into the politics. It's like several of the Republicans who
said, Mary Garland is whose nominee for?
Obama for the
Supreme Court, yeah.
And well, there are Republicans.
I'm just filling in the
blanks.
Right.
So connecting the dots. And there are Republicans
are
who have
come. Are you implying that our audience wouldn't know that?
Just to make it easy for them. And ironically,
I think we've just been had.
There are people, Republicans, that claim this morning that, you know, well, you know, that's not a good candidate, and then they realize, whoa, that would leave a vacancy in the Fourth Circuit, you know, in D.C. It's like, wow, now I'm interested. So, which does play into your comment about its politics, but
well, the other thing yesterday, Trump had meetings with two Russians. And I think it was when he was meeting with the ambassador.
The Russian ambassador.
The Russian ambassador. He refused to allow any American press there, but he allowed Russian press in. I mean, this is just nuts. If you wanted to write something that was absolutely crazy, you couldn't do any more than what's going on now.
What's going on in Washington right now is you say one thing on Monday, on Wednesday you recant that and take another pack, then on Friday you go right back to Monday, or then maybe Wednesday will get involved, but Tuesday could be a problem.
Well, you offer
it seems like nobody has a, you know, they say something, but it doesn't count.
Well, and the way they offered three different reasons for firing Comey, and it was as though, well, we'll throw them all against the wall and see which one sticks. I mean,
And then, it brought Kellyanne Conway back.
Right.
Yeah. And rumors that Spacey was losing his job.
Yeah, it was just a cameo appearance.
Well,
I think, first of all, we have to acknowledge he has the right to fire the man.
He does.
He had every right.
Even though only one other president has ever done it. But he does.
Well,
but I mean, the whole point of having a 10-year appointment to that position is to avoid politics so that you don't have president.
Although, don't you think that Comey himself has been guilty of stepping his toe into the political stuff way too much?
Oh,
that's why you said it makes me a little nauseous.
Yeah.
But it goes back to, you know, what you say on Monday is different than what you say on Wednesday. There's all sorts of evidentiary proof that Trump thought what Comey did was perfectly acceptable. So to use that as a rationale for terminating his employment is unethical. And I think you're right. The President of the United States has the right to terminate or to fire the FBI director. But you would like to think that there were solid grounds on which that decision would be made.
Yeah,
and I think that's what this is all about.
But it's politics. I mean, there's an old saying about we'll burn that bridge when we come to it. I mean, it's just, don't worry, you know, it's just politics.
Well, I think it's not going to go away, and it certainly, I mean, it may have in some ways be supported by his core, but there are a whole lot of other people that aren't solid center core.
But as soon as this happened, the press started howling about, now, is this the basis for impeachment? You want to know why they weren't invited into the meeting with the Russian ambassador? I mean, They're so dead set to run him out of office. I mean, I don't know why he should cooperate with them.
They're dead set to get headlines.
Mm-hmm. That's the business.
They're dead set to run him out of town.
Well, if they run him out of town, they won't have any reason to get headlines on.
And I think
trust me.
I think it depends upon what press you're looking at, because with the polarization of America, I would bet you that if somebody came in and did a nonpartisan assessment of our respective news feeds that we all get, that yours might be a little more conservative than mine, okay, and that you probably get many more news stories that seem to say Trump took a command decision and did the decisive thing.
It was Pence's explanation, right? Yes.
Yeah, just boil it down. It's nice and simple. It's like, you know, and one of the Republicans' answer was suck it up and move on. That was his answer to the people who disagreed. And you know, to me, this is not politics as usual. This is disregard for thinking people. It's a lack of credibility. It's a lack of integrity. And it's a whole new way of dealing with your fellow human being that I believe is unethical.
I think we've gotten the bridge analogy, which gives me a chance to take it back to local. Thank you for that.
It's my job, part of my job.
Part of your job.
This is far better than last week's bridges.
This bridge is a bridge too far, huh?
Oh, last week's bridges didn't exist.
No, I know they were made up, but you know, you got to wing it every now and then. Seriously, the Penn Street Bridge situation. It seems that people have adjusted, as you had suggested they would adjust, and things are going rather smoothly.
I think there's a lot of credit due to the Reading Eagle for publicizing things. I mean, there was an article in last Sunday's paper that included a double truck, where there's two pages side by side.
That was marvelous.
That
it was
really showed the detail and stuff. That was really well done, and we, in conjunction with the county commissioners and the chamber and some others, have developed a nice website thing. and it's been well publicized, and I think that the message has gotten out there.
Are you using a double truck as part of it?
Positively. I mean, it's okay. it's well, sure. I mean, it's there are graphics on the website and stuff. Whether that specific one is there yet, but it certainly is. To me, it seems appropriate.
That'd be a big load to carry.
But it's a lot of preparation.
You know,
and
really,
forewarning.
And I've had people who, you know, I was at a breakfast meeting this morning, and somebody said, you know, yeah, I live down in Exeter, but I think you're right. I came in through the city. I mean, at first, I don't know where he heard me say it, but I mean, it was, he didn't even venture out of the bypass. He may have, who knows. But
I drive by the bridge entrance off of 422 on a frequent basis.
The closed ramp.
And I have yet to see any traffic, any cars that are slowed down thinking that they can get off. What's the next exit, right, if you're going north?
North Wyomissing Boulevard.
North Wyomissing Boulevard. There's more cars that are slowing down and then surprised that they can't get on there because that's blocked off. But there really has been, for all intents and purposes...
North Wyomissing Boulevard
is blocked off.
If it's not that one, what's the next one?
Warren Street.
There is another street that is blocked.
Well, the one after the entrance ramp into Reading is the ramp into West Reading.
Right.
I mean, that's the very next one.
But that's open.
Oh, no, not that one. The one after that is closed.
I think the berm is working on that.
It may have been some temporary.
There's some temporary work.
It's been closed for 2 days. But yeah. That's the only place I have seen any like even minor slowdown. You would not know that there was a bridge, a major bridge.
I think the big issue is going to be with big events at
Santander. All the signage is up for the Santander events. Follow the detour.
Well advised to come early.
Who's the big one? The big star coming in this week, this month, will be a test.
There are a number of folks coming in.
Blazing Saddles. Yeah.
Oh, Mel Brooks.
Mel Brooks, thank you.
That's at the Performing Arts Center.
Oh, is that where he's going to perform? Well, Stone Wall, they're coming over. They're going to have to come over the bridge to see.
But that's a much smaller crowd.
Yeah.
So it won't be as much of an impact.
No, it's much less. I think the fact that the city's going to be spending $300K on painting the bridge and getting the lights up and all that seems a little ironic with the work going on.
I mean, PennDOT was only able to budget to do the bridge, and they agreed that it was a historic structure and they were going to do it accurately and stuff, but then when you get into the lighting and some of that other stuff, I mean, it's just not in the PennDOT budget. Yeah. So the city had to step up, and I think they deserve credit for that they saw this as an opportunity to make this a real gateway into the city and
I was really
dress it up and so on, and they did a good job with it.
I'd much rather see them
spending money on that than spending $700,000 to clean up the fire site, you know.
Well, that didn't go over too well with
on
the
private property. I mean,
it's just awful.
The city manager didn't think that was a good idea either. He said, this is no more wrong. Evidently, we've always done it. The city is always taken care of. And you take a look at landlords, they just seem to be able to say, well, this property's burned down here, I'll give it to you for $1.50. And then you don't. We'll work it and you'll sell it to them for $1.
How is it possible that people who own it aren't responsible?
They've never been held as responsible, evidently.
Yeah, but I mean, legally?
You would think so, but now, you know, it may be the classic can't squeeze any blood out of that particular rock. I mean, it's they don't have insurance and they don't have any. It's held in a corporate name that has no assets or whatever. There you can be stuck, but.
Well, I think the idea with landlords are also mentioning, the city manager said, landlords from now on are going to have to be responsible for what's going on in their building, and if they live in the city. If they don't, they should hire a manager to come in and make sure they're taking care of their properties.
That's a good idea.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but in all honesty, a prominent building like that, and it's very obviously vacant with busted windows and a roof partially collapsed or whatever, I think that there's some responsibility for the city to say to those owners, wait a minute, you got to do something.
In the past, they haven't done it, evidently.
Right.
I think now he's of a mind to do that from now on. You were going to say?
Maybe it's the part of me that spent so many years as a capitalist, but I found myself reading the story about requiring landlords to hire local managers, and I thought, well, there's my post-retirement career. I'm going to go start a property management business. And I really hope that they limit the number of properties, because otherwise we're just starting a whole new sub-business in Reading. You know, it's very easy for a landlord to just go hire somebody. You know, Fred comes in and lives in Wyomissing, so he can't buy property and be a landlord in Reading. He goes and buys 40, 50 properties. He just hires me, and I got to manage all of the properties. So I think you're starting a whole new, whole new layer of management in real estate in Reading.
You want to try it, and we'll see what it shakes out after a year?
Don't take it personally.
Well, don't add that part about me buying 40 or 50 properties.
No, we won't do that. Also, the EPA, whether you love them or not, they're, again, back testing soil for lead residue.
Well, since the state has the second highest level of lead contamination in children in the nation, and since I think it's 85% of the kids in the Laureldale are higher than the minimum level that's considered unsafe, I would say that it's time to reassess what is considered acceptable and unacceptable.
I think it goes back to the way we've always handled things like this. The battery casings were shot, so you bury them. You got junk, you bury them. I remember even when we lived in Philadelphia, people would bury in the small backyards. They would use that rather than pay for their trash to be hauled away. And so we as a culture are apt to bury our mistakes.
Or burn.
Or burn.
Just like doctors.
Ooh. Burn or bury?
Bury.
Bury, yes, okay. Now, on a brighter note, I think a brighter note, Vive la France, the election in France. I was pleasantly surprised to see that the French people have said enough, no mas.
And I wonder how much they learned from us.
Hopefully.
Or if it was just that they were not going to be persuaded by... Well, first of all, it was interesting. They had one of the lowest turnouts ever, and it was higher than, I think, any presidential turnout in the United States.
80%.
Yeah, which was, I thought, interesting that they are so much more attuned to voting than we are.
That's true for almost everywhere.
Yeah, but then to see that Le Pen got, I think, soundly trounced, and we'll see what happens with the parliamentary elections.
Can we say trumped in that context now?
She got trumped, yes. Yeah.
Well, she did get a third of the vote.
She did.
Which is far more than her father got. And
her father's far more right than she.
Yeah, yeah. Mostly rural folks.
What I found interesting is the winner's, I can never say his name right.
Marchand.
I did not do well in French school.
Macron.
The video Macron. That he did.
Thank you.
The winner. The video that he did addressed to Americans. Did you guys see that?
No.
Where he addressed something to the scientists and the of America, saying that you're welcome in France, that we are the land of progressive thinking, that we welcome you. And it was basically an open arms invitation to come move to France. And I think it was a direct...
Or to stay inside the Paris Accord, which is another segue into...
Yes, I think it was also
a come and visit France and
come and visit France, and yes, and by the way, the rest of the world. While you talk about this video, let's talk.
But I thought they were against more immigrants.
Apparently, not the right kind. Just like in the United States, where you can buy visas these days.
Some people can.
Mm-hmm. If you have $500,000.
But with the Paris Accord, do we stay? Do we not stay? Is there a general feeling?
Oh, I think we ought to. I mean, the. Climate concerns ought to be at pretty near the top of our list, and I think protecting the environment in general. We'll see what the president wants to do, but I think it would be a big mistake.
I think there's two rules of thought, and it's not whether you believe that climate change is real or not. It's whether or not, if it is, do you have a moral obligation as a member of the human race to help protect the land and the health of future generations, or do you live for the moment and just try to maximize business and say the hell with regulations and let's just go make America great again?
I don't think anybody on either side of this argument have a desire to have dirty air and dirty water and all that stuff. The question here is whether or not draconian rules that really affect American business substantially actually affect us at all. That's the issue, as to whether we're going to go do all these things and run up the cost for everybody, and does it actually accomplish anything?
Regarding climate change, that's a big question mark. But regarding clean air and water, that has been proven since the 1960s.
But they've already
but they want to undo it. Or at least there are elements in society that want to undo it. The decision to allow coal companies to let their they don't need to keep the streams clean anymore. I mean,
they can dump their runoff.
They can dump, yeah. And
but how many coal companies are left, and how many are back? I haven't seen any statistics about how many coal companies have reemerged after having been shut down. I don't know that there's any great push to do that.
No, but
the idea is still there that you can't pollute the waters. And the same thing with burying the old battery casings in the ground. I mean, that's something that went on and was accepted. Now there are, EPA is beginning to look at that again and again. And how do you clean it up? How much harm can you do to the earth? How much damage can we do?
We have made tremendous strides, and I hate to see us giving that up. And
well, just as with the discussion earlier about why Comey was fired, there's lots of reasons being given. The primary one that I keep seeing from Trump on why we should get out of the Paris Accord is not whether or not climate change is real, but the fact that he claims the other nations are not paying their fair share. Oh. And the reality is that, just using the example of France is actually contributing more per capita than we are. And I believe 45% of the countries that are involved are all paying into the fund, and there are many more that are paying more per capita than what we're paying here in the United States. So,
okay. Now let's take talking about health. Can we move over to Obamacare? Does it stand a chance in the Senate?
You mean the ACE? What is it called? The American
Care Health.
Affordable. It does not seem to stand a chance in the Senate. Certainly not as it is now. Whether the
Do you
Senate,
think the Senate's going to write their own?
Whether the Senate starts from scratch, I think that silly celebration in the Rose Garden after the House passed this awful, awful bill was just a terrible.
It was cute seeing all those guys in suits doing high fives.
But what disturbs me, Mitch McConnell put together this group as a 10 or 13 people.
13.
And they are all
white
men.
Well, which explain why rape is a pre-existing condition.
You'd like to think that maybe he gets it every once in a while, but I don't think he does. And it's just politics as usual. I mean, not to have a single woman on that committee or a person of color.
This is not politics as usual. This is worse. This is intentional pillaging of the American public, as far as I'm concerned, with what they tried to pass for health care. This should be called the absence of health care. This is the opposite. It's the assumption that private industry is going to step up and provide affordable care across the country. What I would foresee coming would be small little doctor's offices going out of business. Think about any of the doctors that you guys have been to, okay, in your lifetime. How many of them are independent offices as opposed to part of St. Joe's or Penn now, all right? I'd like to know how many independent doctors there even are left in Berks County. So what if St. Joe's...
Yeah, that's the result of Obamacare.
Not Obamacare.
I mean, it's the system
companies.
As it exists is... dying a rather quick death. I mean, it can't continue as it is.
That was meant to rescue the previous thing. There was something wrong previously. That's what gave root to Obamacare. Now you're looking at something. Well, I think the problem goes back to the fact that health expenses are going up markedly all over the country. It's more expensive to be ill, and we're finding more and more illnesses. And having said that, I want to jump quickly over to the fact Nightside host Stephen Colbert evidently suggested that our president and the president of Russia were engaged in some sexual activities together. Some people found that a step too far. Did he go over the line? Is there a line?
Yeah, I think he did go over the line. I like Stephen Colbert a lot. And but I was dismayed to hear that particular comment. I mean, it didn't need to be done. He could have made, well, I mean, I think it was tasteless.
But have we lowered the bar? Haven't we lowered the bar?
Well, we have. I mean, if you take a look at any of the, just go to Facebook feeds from all the comedy shows, because the cursing is allowed now. So what he said, in some regards, is no worse than dropping the F-bomb on a regular basis.
Well, that's frequent now.
Which happens all the time. Yeah. It was bleeped, but right?
He basically was just pandering to his crowd. I mean, they got an audience
packed. Well, he's a comedian.
With similar people, and they're going to say outrageous things and feed on that crowd, but it was...
But is there a line in there that should be drawn?
There sure is. I mean, the other night I was watching the Phillies game and fell asleep in front of the TV, woke up at 2 in the morning, and there was an infomercial on for buying CDs or DVDs, I guess, of Bob Hope. And I watched it for a couple of minutes before I turned it off. And, I mean,
it was
the kind of humor that he was telling, which was considered very topical at that point in time, it was so, compared to today, was so bland, it was unreal.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Johnny Carson for Night Show.
Same thing, right?
Well, and the irony is, despite the fact that it was in the past 2 weeks it marked the 20th anniversary of Ellen coming out on her show, who has the number one top, you know, talk show now, you know, that for being nice?
Okay, for being nice, we have to go. I'm so sorry to cut in. Thank you so much for being with us. We hope to see you again next week. Be well.